So how do you believe everything began?
Well, I think the universe began 13.7 billion years ago in the Big Bang. What came before? I have no idea.
So you think the universe began with a big explosion? How absurd.
Well, the Big Bang actually isn't even an explosion at all. We just gave it a bad name. It's actually the expansion of the universe. The only thing the Big Bang actually tells us is that 13.7 billion years ago, the universe was just a tiny baby, smaller than the size of an atom. It then expanded to the size of the observable universe in less than a second. And the universe is actually expanding right now, as we speak. We're literally inside a growing universe.
You know how crazy you sound right now? God creating everything in 7 days sounds a lot more believable than whatever the heck you just told me.
Okay, then let me prove this to you.
All right, so with my fancy little telescope here, if we look out and up at the stars, we can actually see that galaxies are getting further and further away from each other. This could only mean one thing. Space itself is expanding and pushing these galaxies further away. So, logically, if the universe is growing day by day and it was smaller yesterday and smaller still a week ago, then at some point it must have been very, very, very small. You eventually get to a time when the universe was condensed into a tiny, tiny, tiny little space, as if it was just a singular point, a little patch of energy. Okay, so why did it explode? Or sorry, expand? Well, what do you think happens when there's so much energy condensed into a tiny little patch of space? The only thing left for it to do is to expand. Kind of like when you eat too much and your stomach gets bloated. That's literally the whole discovery. Okay, now I get your point. It's not really a big bang, but kind of like a big stretch, because it's just the universe expanding or stretching throughout time. Yes, and that's actually a much better name. I think we should honestly change it to that. Still though, I don't buy it. I believe in God, so I can't believe in this atheist idea about the Big Bang, because that would literally contradict my own beliefs about God creating the universe. Well, first of all, most people think that the Big Bang necessarily excludes God. It doesn't. It's still open to debate what actually came before the Big Bang, or why the universe existed at all. Because keep in mind, the Big Bang doesn't actually explain how the universe came into existence. It assumes it already came into existence and explains how it evolved from 13.7 billion years ago to today. Okay, I get your point. It's like explaining the growth of a tree by looking back and pointing at the seed. But it's a mystery why the seed existed at all. Exactly. Plus, what if the Big Bang is just a theory describing God's evolution? What if God is the energy itself from which everything began? The small point that was there 13.7 billion years ago, which expanded and then became everything we see around us, from stars to planets to you and me. Okay, even if that were true, no scientist would believe that. Aren't they all like against God? Well, actually, many of the world scientists, including the physicists and cosmologists that came up with things like the Big Bang, actually believe in God. In fact, the discoveries of science actually push them to do so. For example, what's often called the fine-tuning of the laws of physics. What's that? Well, the laws of physics actually have these mathematical constants that we get from nature by measuring things. We didn't make them up ourselves. And the weird thing about them is that they have the precise values that creates the perfect conditions for a universe that could develop life. It's literally as if someone was fine-tuning these constants on a cosmic dashboard to create the optimal conditions for a life-developing universe. Can you give me an actual example of one of these constants? Well, one of the most famous is the cosmological constant. This constant actually determines the strength of the force that drives the expansion of the universe. A force that is a kind of anti-gravity, which instead of pushing things together, it basically pulls them apart. But how is it fine-tuned? Well, it turns out that this constant is absurdly precise. It literally has 0.120 zeros and then a 2. And that means that if you change it just a tiny, tiny little bit, it will change the strength of the force that drives the expansion of the universe. And this would be catastrophic. How so?
Well, since gravity is basically what pushes matter together to create stars, and then pushes stardust together to create planets, that means that if anti-gravity was just a little bit stronger, it would have prevented gravity from forming stars, and thereby also planets. Which of course means we would have never existed, and we would not be having this conversation. Wow, that one's actually crazy. Are there more examples? Yes, there's actually more than 30 of them. Some of these include the constant that determines the mass of the particles that make up your body, and others include the strength of the force that holds these particles together. The universe is literally littered with these things. It's literally as if we were Goldilocks and everything around us was just right. Doesn't this kind of say that there must be a God, you know, some intelligence behind it all? Well, that's one possible explanation. Okay, so what's another? The other is actually infinite universes. What? I know, it's crazy. This idea literally tells us that we live in an infinite multiverse, like the one from Marvel, and that we just happen to have hit the cosmic jackpot and we ended up in the universe that's just right for us. Wait, how so? Well, given that there would be infinite universes out there and many that are not fine-tuned, this basically just says that there has to be some that are. And we just happen to be in one of them because obviously that's the only one that we could exist in. Okay, I get what you mean, but still, it doesn't seem very reasonable to me. For all we know, this is the only universe and there's no such thing as a multiverse because we can never really know. You're right, but in science, it's actually normal to propose the existence of things that we can observe in order to explain the things that we can, like the fine-tuning. Which basically leaves you with only two options to explain the fine-tuning of the universe. Either number one, you propose the existence of an infinite amount of unobservable universes, or number two, you propose the existence of an unobservable creator. So God could be real? Well, this doesn't actually tell us what type of creator it is, or what type of creative intelligence it is. It only tells us that there may be an intelligence or a creator behind it. But that could literally be a super advanced civilization, a scientist growing a universe in a lab, or yes, a god. Which, mind you, could also be a completely impersonal god, like the Force from Star Wars. You know, that actually kind of makes sense. Perhaps what you said before about the energy of the universe being God is partly true, and that energy is just conscious and intelligent, and it's been guiding the evolution of the universe from within. Yup, and like Obi-Wan and Yoda once said, it's an energy that surrounds us, penetrates us, and binds the galaxies together. You know, this is actually pretty amazing. I didn't know science could tell us this much about the universe. It's as if when you're studying the laws of nature, you're looking into the mind of God. Well, in a way, yes, if you believe in God. And funny enough, that's actually what Einstein said. He said, "I want to know God's thoughts. The rest are just details." So you're telling me Einstein believed in God? What did he do? Pray to him and ask him for the solution to the laws of physics? Well, no. Einstein did not believe in a personal God. He himself said that the idea was childlike to him. He actually believed in an impersonal God, like the Force. You keep mentioning those two words, but I don't even know what they mean. Can you explain what personal and impersonal God means? Okay, so generally speaking, there's only two types of God. A personal God and an impersonal God. Literally every single religion has this. Can you give me some examples? Okay, well in Hinduism, there's Saguna Brahman and Nirguna Brahman, or God with attributes and God without attributes. Which basically means either God as a form or God as the formless source of reality, which is beyond all names, forms, and attributes. Christianity has this too. There's God as the personal father or God as the impersonal light. So as you can see, one is personified into a sort of person or form, and the other remains impersonal and formless. Most people know the personal God. It's the God with a gender, the one that you pray to and you ask for things like you would Santa for a Christmas present. Not a lot of people know the impersonal God, because it's the God that's never dumbed down to our level. It remains wholly transcendent, formless, and sometimes unknowable. So we can't know God? Well, not exactly. There's actually a whole area of religion that tries to know the impersonal God through direct experience. It's called mysticism, but that's a topic for another conversation. "You know, you're leaving me a lot to think about. I thought that I believed in God, but now I'm realizing that I may have actually just believed in a symbol for God. Why do humans do that?" Well, we personify the divine in order to understand and relate to it. We bring God to our level by giving it a name and form and personifying it as something that looks like us. It's a way for humans to form a kind of personal relationship with God by seeing God as a person. Some personified into a father figure or a son like Christianity, and others into a blue-skinned deity like Hinduism with Krishna. But in reality, whatever God is, most of us know that it's much more than just the name and form we ascribe to it. It's not just a man in the clouds, but the transcendent source of reality from which all things come. You know, for being a scientist, you do sure know a lot about God and religion. Well, actually, I'm as much of a religious person as I am a scientist. It just depends on the part of reality that I want to understand and what I feel like learning about that day. Because you see, science, mysticism, and religion are just different ways of understanding the same reality, each with their own set of tools. For example, science tries to understand reality through the tool known as the scientific method, through things they can observe and measure. That's why they can only tell us things about the physical universe. Religion understands reality through what they call revelation, which is kind of like a form of channeling because it's literally getting things from a higher source, whether that be God or maybe even aliens or some advanced civilization. And mysticism understands reality through transcendent experiences. That's why it can only tell us things about the ultimate reality or the impersonal God. So because they all use different tools to understand reality, they all understand a different part of reality itself. So why do we debate about whether religion or science is right? Well, it's like the blind man and the elephant. They're all touching a different part of reality, a different part of the elephant. So they're obviously going to argue about what part of the elephant is actually the true reality. So it's only because people have different points of view that they debate about which one is right, and mostly because they don't understand that each point of view is looking at the same thing. Exactly, and I think it would be much easier if we all just got together and understood that we're all living in the same mystery. In front of us is the same elephant, and we're all just trying to understand what the heck it is. And the only way to do that is to look at the big picture, to bring all of our perspectives together and to understand that they're just different parts of the same elephant, or different puzzle pieces of the same puzzle, reality itself.